Morning.
Welcome. During the century and also those online. Here at Wesley, we foster a sanctuary culture by creating a safe environment where all feel welcome, loved, accept the value and the form for who they are through intentional practices such as empathy, compassion, generosity, hospitality, and empathy. If you are on Zoom, please register your attendance by recording your name and the names of those who participate in worship with you in a chat address to a meeting post by the list monthly. For those who are in this sanctuary, please fill out our attendance slip and put it in the offering plate during the collection of the offering. Okay, and again, please remember to wear your name tags. It is important, not just for me, I think, but for our congregation to recognize you. Okay, let us begin in a spirit of worship. Please stand in body, voice, and spirit for the call to worship. Though darkness seems to envelop us,
Jesus breaks through the word of peace.
Fears are banished.
Hope is more than a sword.
Rejoice, the Lord is with us.
We rejoice in the peace and blessings he brings.
Okay, please remain standing to sing Thy Be the Glory, found in the United Methodist hymnal number 308, and pray songs as well. Father of the risen Jesus, we praise you for the great love that you have shown to redeem us by sending your Son Jesus. Help us today to embrace the new life that the resurrected Christ is giving us, a life beyond our doubts, faith over fear, courage over confusion, belief over disbelief, and trust to follow your guidance. As we worship today, help us to feel the presence of resurrected Jesus in our midst, reminding us of your love and our purpose. Amen. Our children, please come forward for children's conversation.
Because it's he sought for himself. But the end of the story tells us that those who believe in Jesus without being able to see him with our own eyes are blessed. So again, we can't see Jesus in the same way that Thomas and the other disciples did, but for more than 2,000 years, people who are Christians have believed in Jesus without being able to see him face to face. And we can still know Jesus through the stories of the Bible and through the actions of other people who do things that Jesus would do, loving, caring for other people. So before you head off to Sunday school, let's have a prayer together. I'm going to ask you to repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for all the people who helped me to know you. Make my faith strong so I can see for myself how you are at work in the world. Live in me. Amen. Okay, then I'll head off to Sunday school with Miss Cordelia. She's waiting over there for you.
Holy God, we glorify you for saving us through Jesus, in whom we receive a living hope. Open our eyes to the resurrection that you place in our lives. Open our minds and hearts to your love that awareness, we step over the poor on our way to get more and more, ignoring their needs. Holy Jesus, forgive us. Take away whatever pours us back. Humble us. We may learn the life you intend for us. Show us the way to generosity. Awaken us to hope and action, that we may live by faith and spread your love for all. Let your church be dressed for action, enlightened and alert for the coming of your kingdom. As your children, we will not keep silence. You ask us, speak to the leaders to cease from evil and violence. Lord, to do good, to seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the marginalized, and plead for the voiceless. Inspire us that we may be faithful servants to one another, alert to open the doors of hospitality and friendship. Loving God, we thank you that no person anywhere in this world is a nobody to you. There never has been and never will be an insignificant person. Whenever one poor child suffers, you call out our names to become your hands and feet. The world is full of people who do not have enough to eat, drink, or a safe place to live. Focus us on helping those people. This day may people struggle in the pain of disease, weakness, distress, and loneliness. Please be with everyone in need of healing, especially all those in our prayer list, those we name in our hearts now, and all our elderly members. Send upon them your Holy Spirit. Bring your love and healing grace. They shall be comforted and strengthened. O God, receive these prayers as we pray to our risen Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The bounty of God's grace has blessed us in so many ways. In our giving, let us give from the heart. Let our gift be seeds of abundant justice and hope for our neighbors near and far. Ushers, please come forward to collect our offerings. may be seated. The epistle reading this morning is from the first letter of Paul, chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with your indescribable and glorious joy, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Please stand in body or spirit for the reading of the Gospel. The Gospel reading this morning is from the Gospel according to John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. This reading is from the Common English Bible. It was still the first day of the week. That evening, while the disciples were behind the closed doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. When the disciples saw the Lord, they were filled with joy. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I am sending you." Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sin, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Thomas, the one called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he replied, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my finger in his wounds left by the nails, and put my hands into his side, I will not believe." After 8 days, his disciples were again in a house, and Thomas was with them. Even though the doors were locked, Jesus entered and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Look at my hands. Put your hands into my side. No more disbelieve. Believe." Thomas responded to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." Jesus replied, "Do you believe because you see? Happy are those who do not see and yet believe." Then Jesus did many other miraculous signs in his disciples' presence, signs that are not recorded in this scroll. But these things are written so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son, and that believing you will have life in his name. This is the word of God for the people of God. Please remain standing as we sing "We Walk by Faith," number 2196, "In the Face We Sing."
us pause for a moment of centering and a word of prayer. God of living hope, of new life and transformation, open our ears to hear your word proclaimed in this place. Open our hearts to know your love offered in this congregation. Open our eyes to see your presence blessing us in this moment. We pray in the name of the risen Christ. Amen. Happy Easter. As we continue our celebration of the great 50 days of Easter, we find ourselves confronted with a gospel reading that some commentators label as one of the most quintessential stories in all the gospels. So much so that it has given birth to a term that even in the secular world people recognize, the label Doubting Thomas. But in that label, at least as popularly understood, and even as many Christians have come to understand Thomas's story, is embodied a great deal of misunderstanding. That this passage is felt to convey significant insight into the life of faith is attested to by the fact that it is the gospel reading for the second Sunday of Easter in each of the three annual cycles of the Revised Common Lectionary. It is not read each year because it is a story of judgment and reprimand for an unfaithful follower. Instead, it is meant to be a story of hope and promise, a story that demonstrates deep faith. Thomas's moniker notwithstanding, the word doubt appears nowhere in this text in the original Greek. Yes, as translated in the NRSV, for example, we do hear Jesus say to Thomas, "Do not doubt, but believe." But as translated more accurately in the version read today from the Common English Bible, the contrast is between belief and unbelief, as Jesus urges Thomas, "No more disbelief, believe." To fully appreciate the depth of Thomas's faith and commitment to Jesus, we need to be aware of how Thomas is presented overall in John's Gospel. Earlier in John's story, as Jesus is preparing to travel to Bethany, a village near Jerusalem, after receiving word of Lazarus's illness and death, while most of the disciples urged Jesus to stay away from Jerusalem in view of his opponents seeking his death, it was Thomas who declared, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." He might then be called Courageous Thomas. The next time Thomas is specifically mentioned is in the upper room at the Last Supper, when Jesus is explaining to the disciples that though he's going away, they know the way to the place where he is going. Thomas responds, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Here, questioning Thomas is seeking deeper understanding. So now let us return to the story of Thomas in the upper room on the Sunday 1 week after the resurrection, when he has heard of Jesus' appearance the previous week to the other disciples, but has not yet seen it for himself. Jesus returns to show Thomas his wounds and does not condemn Thomas for doubting, for longing for proof. Instead, Jesus invites Thomas into deeper relationship. And that is what Thomas was seeking all along, an authentic encounter with the risen Christ, so that he could own his faith based on his personal experience, not just through hearsay. Yes, he might perhaps be called skeptical Thomas, but we would do well to remember that healthy skepticism is not doubting something just for the sake of doubting, but instead it is questioning things to discover a truth that will help you arrive at a conclusion you can claim for your own. In the end, Thomas's confession, "My Lord and my God," is the most definitive human claim about Jesus' identity and one of the strongest declarations of faith in the entire New Testament. Thomas's longing, questioning, yearning for real encounter leads to his personal conviction of the presence of Christ with him. His example leads us to consider the ways we know the risen Christ's presence among us, as well as all the way God transforms our misunderstanding and our doubts. Our questions, and even our doubts, especially if we articulate them to God, form the basis of deeper relationship with God and further our understanding of our faith. Questions can arise from deep faith, from wanting to understand more fully and claim faith as our own. It is in wrestling and struggling with questions and uncertainties that we grow in faith. Transformation comes from questions, not answers. The full story of Thomas shows us that questioning, doubts, skepticism, none of it form barriers to faith, but instead allow us to grow in faith and deepen our relationship with God. There are indeed many reasons why we might be asking questions of ourselves, of our church, of our faith, of God at this time. We live in a society and a world divided by racism, xenophobia, war, gun violence, environmental crises. Where is the resurrected Christ? We live in uncertain times with many questions about the viability of the institutional church and our denomination in particular, amidst discouraging realities of splintering, disaffiliation, and dwindling church attendance exacerbated by COVID. Like the disciples in the beginning of today's gospel, we very well might want to hide behind closed doors, gripped by fears about our future, fears that risk our becoming paralyzed, limiting our ability to see God's presence and movement among us. The epistle reading, written to those who have not yet seen and yet believe, reminds us that facing hardship, opposition, and questions has been a reality for the church since its early days and throughout the centuries. The recipients of Peter's letter were in crisis, finding themselves ostracized and alienated from their pagan society, experiencing exclusion and hostility because of their religious beliefs. We might identify with this sense of alienation in a world and society that is increasingly secular and post-Christian. But our reading also calls us to the living hope in which the life of faith is grounded. It affirms that hope is embodied in faith that trusts the God, that trusts that God, the God is with the faithful in the present, in our current circumstance. Our Easter celebration of Jesus' resurrection reminds us that new life is always possible, no matter what discouragement or difficult circumstances we may be facing. God is always ready to guide us beyond the obstacles to the next new thing. The theme of today's message, Reclaim, Revive, Renew, is taken from a letter sent in early Lent by Bishop Thomas Bickerton, President of the Council of Bishops, on behalf of the Council. Speaking to the circumstances facing our denomination, it is entitled, Lent Message, Time to Reclaim, Revive, and Renew our United Methodist Church. I want to read a portion of the concluding exhortation. This is the time for the United Methodist Church to pivot away from old behaviors into a new vision for how God can use this church to be a beacon of God's love for all. It is time to move from division and focus on the unity of the beloved community given to us by our loving God. It is time to move from paralysis and fatigue and focus on the life-giving mission and ministry we are called to offer as guided by the Holy Spirit. It is time to move from sadness over what has been and focus with anticipation on the future, with the hope that God will open to us. It is time, maybe let that God will guide us as we reclaim, revive, and renew our beloved United Methodist Church. The three words, reclaim, revive, renew, encapsulate the message of Easter, the promise of Christ's resurrection, and what it means for us as Christians to be and live as an Easter people. I believe these three words around which we might base our questions, not only for the future of our denomination, for us as individual followers of Christ, seeking to live more fully into Jesus' call for us, and also as we prepare to celebrate the centennial of the merger that became this congregation, maybe especially for us as a congregation. What in our life together do we need to reclaim, revive, and or renew as we move into our second century? To reclaim means to recover something that has been lost. Perhaps in this age of disaffiliations, we might reclaim what it means to be United Methodist. We might remind ourselves of the essential core of the Methodist tradition and Wesleyan theology, such as John Wesley's three general rules: do no harm, do good, stay in love with God. We could consider what the current BUMC campaign calls the foundations of Wesleyan theology, a theology of grace, anchored in scripture, and based in the life and teachings of Jesus Christ and the continuing movement of the Holy Spirit. What does that look like for us? To revive implies bringing something back, to restore something to flourishing. We might well ponder the revivals and camp meetings of the early Methodist movement, large gatherings that stirred religious fervor. What is needed for the modern-day equivalent to awaken fervor and revive our congregation? Still emerging from the effects of the pandemic, we seek to recover the full vitality of our worship and our programs and ministries, but we also could ask what new forms they might take. To renew can mean simply to resume something after an interruption, and in that sense it overlaps a bit with what I've just said about revival, but it can also connote making extensive changes. We may very well want to renew our sense of commitment to following God's purposes for us and to participation in the basic mission of the United Methodist Church, to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Yet living into that mission may presently require very different forms. There is much to unpack and discern, and many questions to ask. The Doubting Thomas element of this passage frequently overshadows the rest of the story, that of Jesus breathing the Spirit to empower the community to continue Jesus' work of making God and God's ways known in the world. To celebrate the resurrection is to celebrate the beginning of the Church's mission in the world, a mission we have inherited. Jesus' resurrection brought new life to the followers who became the early Church, fostering the growth of a new community of persons who nurtured and supported one another. Today, as we ask questions about what it means to be and do Church in our times, Jesus' resurrection can do the same for us. Revive and renew us as a faith community that nurtures and supports and carries on the mission and ministry of Jesus. In today's gospel reading, Jesus blesses those who don't see and yet believe, and of reference to literal physical eyesight. But there is also a metaphorical sense in which we all can come to see for ourselves. For we can consider the connotation of seeing as meaning to understand, as when someone offers us an explanation and we respond, "Ah, now I see." Coming to that form of sight is what the faith journey is all about, and it happens differently for each of us. While our own personal stories of encounters with Jesus are varied, I would guess that in many cases our coming to know and experience Jesus has been mediated by a community of faith, such as this body of believers has been for 100 years, and through participation in the programs and ministries thereof, through study and interpretation of Scripture, through the convincing verbal testimony of others, or through the witness of their role-modeling behavior and actions, through prayer, through sacred music, through worship and sacrifice. That is what we will celebrate next week, the faithful people who came together to form this congregation 100 years ago, and the faithful actions of all who have participated in the ministries of this congregation over the years. We will celebrate those who had courage and vision to live into the uncertainties of the new faith as it formed 100 years ago, and with whom we are in continuity. So as we move ahead in the coming weeks, months, and years, beyond the celebration of our first century as a faithful body of Christ, let us ponder what it means to reclaim, revive, and renew our beloved Wesley United Methodist Church in order to meet the challenges of a different time. Let us formulate, ponder, and then live into those questions which will enable us to live fully, courageously, and faithfully into the new life to which God is calling us as individuals, as a congregation, as a denomination. May it be so. Amen. The heart of God's call and Christ's Easter commissioning of the community of faith is for us not to remain hidden behind locked doors in a church building, but to go forth to love and serve the world. I invite you to stand in body or spirit and sing our closing hymn, Go Make of All Disciples, found in the United Methodist Hymnal, page 571.
Thank you.
Let us go from this time and place of worship into the world, knowing that we are not alone when doubts and fears surround us. The risen Christ is with us, empowering and encouraging us for transformational living. May Easter joy fill you and fuel your journey as we ask in the wake of the resurrection, what now? And may the power of resurrection, the divine peace, and the empowering grace of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us now and forevermore. Amen.